Hi, I'm Evan from the University of New South Wales, and today we'll be going over Bubblesort. If we have two elements, 2 and 1, then we can simply sort them by just swapping them. It is this simple concept that allows Bubblesort to be one of the simplest of sorting methods. If we take a larger case, however, for example, if you have 5 elements, then we can formally apply this concept by continuously comparing two adjacent elements, swapping them if they are out of order, and then continuously repeating until our list is sorted. So for example, if we take 3 and 4, 3 is small and 4, so we continue. 4 is bigger than 2, and so we swap them. 4 is small and 5, so we continue. And then 5 is bigger than 1, so we swap it. And now we want to repeat this another 3 times, since our list is of size 5. And so we start again. 3 is bigger than 2, so we swap them. 3 is small and 4. 4 is bigger than 1, so we swap them. And then 4 is smaller than 5. Now we repeat again. 2 is smaller than 3. 3 is bigger than 1, so we swap them. 3 is smaller than 4. And 4 is smaller than 5. Now we do this one more time. 2 is bigger than 1, so we swap them. And then 2 is smaller than 3. 3 is smaller than 4. And 4 is smaller than 5. And now our list is sorted. Now that we know how Bubblesort works, how would we calculate its efficiency? Well, if we have a reverse list, which would be our worst case, then for every element in the reverse list, we'd have to move it up, bubbling it to its position. This would require n squared operations. And so if we had an array of 1,000 elements, we'd have to do 1 million comparisons, comparing one element to every other element in the list. If we go back to our sorted list, you might even notice how, even if our list is already sorted, we'd still have to go through every 2 elements, check if they're sorted or not, and then repeat for every iteration. And so it would still require n squared operations to do this. And while there are small changes and optimizations we can make, Bubblesort will never be faster than n squared. Now we'll look at how to implement Bubblesort using code.
Hello, so we're going to implement our example in code now. And so we're going to start by creating an array of size 5. And we want to hash define our magic number to be max size. And then we'll just do it up here. Cool. All right. We've also implemented some function that we're going to be using, which will be swap print array and print pairs, just to make things a bit easier to see and use. Right, so we finish this off by finishing this. 2, 5, 1. So these were the numbers we used in our example from before. And the first thing we wanted to do is print our array so we know what we're actually looking at. So we call the function print array. And then it will take in array and max size. Cool. So if we save this now and compile it, we just use gcc minus war minus error bubblesort.c and then output it as bubblesort. And then run it. We'll see we just print the numbers 3, 4, 2, 5, and 1. Cool. So now we're going to sort them. So we're going to need our bubblesort function. We'll just create it here. So bubblesort is going to return nothing because it's going to swap the elements in place and is going to take in an array which is made up of ints. It has a size, so we know when to stop iterating through the array. And that's it. Cool. All right. So we're going to pretend to use it here. And then once we're done, we're going to print the array again, just to see that we've actually sorted it. Cool. Okay, so now that we've finished that part, let's actually get into coding the function itself. So we can just copy our code from up here. since that's how it's going to be defined. All right. So now we remember that Bubblesort works by continuously swapping adjacent elements until the whole list is sorted. And we need to keep doing this for every element. So we're going to need two while loops, one to go through every element and another to go through every element for every element. And so we're going to need first a variable to store a while loop counter, initiate that to zero, and then while while i is less than the size of the array, but we want to go one minus it because we're going to be doing it only for the amount of numbers we have in array minus one. We also can't forget to actually increment our variable. All right, so now that we have that, we can just do a simple test to see that this is working as intended. Just so we know we're on the right track. Cool, so let's run it over here. Cool, so we have 0, 1, 2, 3, and that's it, because that's our I variable. All right, cool. So now that we know that that's working, we then want another while loop to go through every element for each element. So we do the same thing again. First, we want a variable, because our while loop needs three things. A variable to start from. Let me just correct my indenting here. Okay, so we then want j to go until size minus one, because we only want to be swapping every two elements, and if we go all the way to the max size, then we'll be swapping the current element with the next element, which would be outside of the bounds of the array. So we do this, and then again, we'll need to increment our variable. All right, cool. So now, again, we can do a small test. %d, and then I. Cool, so we can parse that. Cool, so now you can see we're going through every pair of elements for the entire array. Great, so now that we're going through every pair of elements, let's actually try printing out what those elements are. So instead of printing out I and j themselves, we can print out array I and array j. Oh no, we don't want array I and j, because I is our variable higher up. We want to be doing I plus one. So if we save that again, cool. And now you might see how we've got 3 and 4, 4 and 2, 2 and 5, and 5 and 1. Oh no, see, this is why it, as I was saying before, it broke, because these should be J instead. Cool, everyone makes mistakes. Cool, all right, why is my window disappearing? Once more. Cool, all right, let's do it again. Alright, so now you can see how we've got the pairs 3 and 4, 4 and 2, 2 and 5, 5 and 1, and then we start again going through every pair multiple times. Cool. So now that we know what we're actually working with, we can implement what we want to implement. And so we can, the concept of bubble sort is swapping if they're out of order. So the first thing we want to do is checking if our elements are out of order. So since we know the elements that we want to check is j and j plus 1, we check that array j is, if array j is, and we want to be checking if the higher, sorry, the out of order, if array j is bigger than array j plus 1. Cool. Okay, and then if that does happen, let me just delete this for now. Then we want to swap them. And so to do this, we'll just use our swap function. And swap takes in the array itself and the position of the first element, which is j, position of the next element, which is j plus 1. Cool. Okay, let's just scroll this down a bit. All right, so now we can even do another test just to see what elements we're actually swapping. So let's run that again. All right. It's frozen. Why is it frozen? Ah, we have forgotten and accidentally deleted our increments for j. And they should go here. Cool. All right. Cool, so now we're only printing out the elements that are out of order, which is 4, 2, 5, and 1, etc. Alright, so you might also notice how we've actually, since we've swapped them, our array to finish has actually been sorted. Now that our bubble sort function is actually finished, we can make things a bit simpler to understand by using our print pairs function. And print pairs will simply just take the array, the size of the array, and then the x and y locations of the first thing, the positions of the things we're looking at, and j and I. You don't need to understand this, we're just going to be doing it as a way of showing more in detail how Bubblesort works. Cool. So now you can see we've printed out the array unordered, and then we have a blue signifying that we're looking at the two elements, and then red signifying that these two elements are out of order, so we're going to be swapping them on next time round. And so you notice how we're looking at every element, every pair of elements, four times, because we're looking at size minus 1, which is 4. And so we compare these and these again. So if we take this slowly, we look at 3 and 4 as our pair. 3 and 4 are not out of order, so we continue. 4 and 2 are out of order, and so then we call the swap function, and then we continue, and we go 4 and 5. 4 and 5 are not out of order, so we go on. Then 5 and 1 are out of order, and so we swap them. In the next iteration, you'll see how 5 and 1 and 4 and 2 have been swapped. Now that we've reached the end of the list, we want to start again. So we go back to the beginning. 3 and 2 are out of order, so we swap them. So now you'll see in the next iteration, 2 and 3 are in order, and then 3 and 4 are not in order, and so that stays as it is. And we continue doing this for every single element until each one has moved its way to the top. Cool. Oh, yes, and let's not forget our variables. Oh, sorry, our comments. I'm going to compare with every other element, and then we print out the pairs that we want to print out the array, and then if out of order, we then swap them. Cool. And that's just the basics of Bubblesort. Of course, there are small things here that you can change around and fidget with such that you can make it more efficient. But again, doing so won't actually make Bubblesort any faster than n squared. Thank you.